Well, hello, Internet, and welcome to part 26 of my Ultimate Python 3 tutorial series. In this part of the tutorial, we're going to focus 100% on threads. All right, so when you use threads, it's like you're running multiple programs at once, and a thread is just a block of code that executes. That's all it is. And what we are going to specifically target in on here is threads that are going to take turns executing. While one executes, all of the other ones are going to sleep until it's their turn to start executing again. What we're going to do here first is import the threading module. We are also going to import time so that we can do really nice formatting with time, and import random, which you've seen many times before. So I'm going to start off here just by creating an example. I'm going to call this function execute thread, and I'm going to use string formatted time here. So I just want to give you a rundown. I'm only going to use part of it, but I want to show you all the different things you can do. Basically, what it allows you to do is define how time is going to be displayed. So I'm just going to use hours, minutes, and seconds, but you could also come in here and define years. Basically, it just allows you to do really nice styling of time. So you could say something like year and month and day, put a space inside of there, and then hour and minute and second. And then you could go and get time by just going GM time like that. And this is specifically from our time module that we have. And the GM time is also from our time module. All right, so you can play around with that, but I'm going to use it here in the tutorial right now, actually. So what I'm going to do to start off this function is print when a thread is going to go to sleep. So I'm going to say print thread sleeps at, and then I'm going to call format, and I'll throw I inside of here. And then after that, I am going to go time dot string formatted time. And I'm just going to print out hours, minutes, and seconds. So hours, colon, minutes, colon, and seconds, so that we can be very precise. And then I'll call time. And there we go. All right, so we'll be able to show all of this. And we will pass I inside of here that's going to reference the index. Each of the threads that executes is going to have a number assigned to it. Then what I want to do is generate a random sleep period between 1 and 5 seconds. So I'm going to say rand sleep time is equal to random rand int. Let's just do it 1 to 4 seconds. That's long enough. Then I want to pause execution of code in this function for that set random amount of time. So I'm going to go time sleep, rand, sleep time. And then I want to print out information after that sleep time. So I'm going to say print thread, and this is going to be the index that identifies each of the threads. Sleeping at, and then call format again with I, and then we're going to go and get this guy again and just copy it and paste it inside of there. Got an extra parentheses, looks like. Or not enough. There we go. All right, so that's what that function's going to do for us. Then outside of it, I'm going to say for I in range 10, change this to I, and then each time through the loop, a thread object is going to be created. And we're going to pass it the function to execute and any arguments to pass to that method. So the arguments passed in this situation is going to be the number that is going to be that's going to identify each of the threads. So I'm going to say thread threading dot thread target is going to be the function that we want to call, which is going to be execute thread, which we just created. And then the arguments that are going to be passed in is the identification number for each of the threads. So that's going to be I. And you have to put a comma after this because the arguments passed to this function must be a sequence, which is the reason that comma is there. All right, and then we just say thread start, and then what we want to do after that is display the active threads. So I'm going to say print active threads, or active threads, and then we can say threading active count. And then we can also return a list of all the active thread objects. So we could say print thread objects. And to do that, you say threading enumerate. All right. And we can run it. And you're going to see here how the threads are working. So active threads, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. You can see here, random thread 3 is going to sleep, and the time that it starts to sleep, thread 5 sleeps at, thread 7 sleeps at, 9, 2, 3. You can see here that this thread is actually stopping its sleep cycle, and it'll continue through its execution. And you can see 9 and 8 on all these other different threads, and how they are going to stop randomly because we all gave them random sleep times. All right, so there's just an example on how we can put threads to sleep and how we can have them run randomly. Now, you're also going to be able to subclass the thread object and then define what happens each time a new thread is executed or run. So let's create a class here, and I'm going to call this custom thread. And how you do this is you pass in threading and thread. Define our initialization function, and then I'm going to say threading threading thread and have that initialize. Then we can say self name is equal to a name that's passed in, so let's have this pass in a name. And then we have to define our run function. And this is just going to call get time, which I will create here in a second. And it'll pass in a name. And then let's also come in and say thread and get the name. And then say that execution ends. So let's create get time now. And I'm going to define it outside of the class. So get time. And we said we're going to pass in a name. And inside of this, it's going to say when a thread sleeps. So thread and the name of it sleeps at, and we will get a time for that. Format the name. Again, we're going to use string formatted time. Hour and minute and second. Time, GM time. And then random sleep time. It's going to be equal to random int. And let's do 1 through 4 seconds. And then we can put it to sleep by passing in the random sleep time. So now what we can do is go and create thread objects. So I'll just call this thread 1 and custom thread. And the name we're going to give it is just 1, just to keep it simple. And yes, that's fine. And then we will create a second one. 2, give it the name of 2, and now what we'll be able to do is start thread execution, which is actually going to call the run function in this situation, even though it's called start. So we're going to say start thread 2, also start. We can do a whole bunch of things. We can check if our thread is alive or not, so we can say thread 1 alive. And to do that, we just go thread one and then go is alive. Do the same thing for thread two. Copy and paste and do and change this to two as well. We could also go and get a thread name. So print thread one name. Pretty straightforward. And of course, to do that, you'd go thread one, get name. You'd also be able to change the thread's name by just changing this to set name instead of get name, if you'd like to do that. So thread two name, thread two. And then we can call join on thread one. So it'll wait for all of the other threads to exit. And do the same for our second thread. And then just to know that everything has finished execution, we can say execution ends. Run it. Whoops. Put a comma in there instead of a period. And there you can see. Thread 1 sleeps at 1906. Thread 2 sleeps. We tested if they were alive. We went and printed their name. And you can see that execution ends. All right. So cool stuff. And now I'm going to show you how to use synchronizing threads so that we can simulate a bank account. All right, so you can lock other threads from executing. So in this situation where we're trying to model a bank account, we have to make sure the account is locked down during a transaction so that if more than one person tries to withdraw money at once, we don't give out more money than is in the account. So we're going to create bank account and threading and thread. So this is a sort of real world example. And we can define our account balance. And let's say we start them off with $100. Let's go and initialize any bank account objects that are created. And it is going to be, I'm going to pass in name, and I'm also going to pass in money request. And we could say threading to initialize this. There it is. And pass in self as well. And then we just go and assign our name that's passed inside of it, as well as the money that was requested. There we are. And then inside of this, we define what's going to happen whenever they call for it to start. Do that in the run function. So the very first thing I want to do is get a lock to keep other threads from accessing our account. So I'm going to go thread lock acquire, and we're going to define thread lock here in a second outside of this class. So let's just do it now. And to create a lock, we just go thread, let's keep our naming consistent, thread lock is equal to threading lock, like that. So let's change this to thread lock. And then after we do that, I want to call a method that's going to try to get money out of the bank account. And this is going to be a static method, so I can just use the name of our class. And this is going to be called getMoney. And also, I'm going to, after we go through that process, I know that everything worked out, so I can release our lock. How you do that is go thread lock release. So now let's create that static method. And how we create static methods is to define it as a static method like that. And then get money, and a customer is going to be passed inside of there, and we will say print and say that somebody tries to withdraw a certain amount of money out of our account at, and we're going to get the time that they tried to get that money out of the account. So format, go and get our customer name and customer money request, and then also our time that this was all done. So time and string with our formatted time. Again, we're going to use the same styling that we have used previously. There we go. And get our current time whenever this occurs. There we go. Then after we do that, we're going to check if there's money in the account. So I'm going to say if bank account and get our account balance minus customer, the money that they requested. If that's greater than zero, well then we know we can handle this. So we will say bank account and, whoops, there we are, account balance, and subtract the amount that they requested, money request. And then on top of that, we can print out a statement. So new account, balance is, and we can go and put that amount out there, and then follow that up with format bank account balance and get the account balance and output it. And else, if the amount they wanted is more than what you have, I'm going to say print not enough money in account, and then we can print out the current balance. So let's just go and copy this, paste that in there, and let's change this to current balance to show them how much money is available. And then after we do this, we could say, outside of the if and else statement, we can say time and sleep. And there we go. And now that we have that set up, we can test everything. So we got our thread lock. I'm going to create some new accounts. So I'm going to create Doug is equal to and bank account. And we'll just pass inside of there. Doug and one. He's trying to get $1 out. And the next person is Paul. And Paul is going to try to get out $100, which we won't be able to do. And then Sally is trying to, we're not going to be able to overdraft the account, like most banks are happy to let you do if you're willing to give them money. Sally's going to try to get $50. And now what we want to do is start our threads. And how we start them is just go Doug and start, and Paul and start, and Sally start. And then we want our threads to be forced to wait for our other ones to stop. Paul and join, and Sally join. All right. And then we could print another message, but that's fine. So let's run it. And you can see here, Doug tries to withdraw $1 at that time. New account balance is $99. Paul tries to withdraw $100. Not enough money. Current balance is $99. Sally tries to withdraw $50. New account balance is $49. So there you go, guys. There's multiple different examples on how we can use threads. And in upcoming tutorials, I'll use them more. And like always, please leave any questions or comments down below. Otherwise,